Hello guys, welcome to the lecture series on computer communication networks. So in this video lecture, we will be considering the concepts from module 3, that is connecting devices. Myself, Abhilash KJ, assistant professor, Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering, will take you guys through the session. So in this video lecture, we will be covering the concepts, the introduction to the connecting devices, then we have from the family of connecting devices, we have hubs and link layer switches, then we consider routers, and finally we will consider the virtual local area networks. So, in the previous video lectures, we have considered the concept of wired Ethernet, wired local area network or Ethernet, and wireless local area network, that is Wi-Fi. Both of the cases, the term network is nothing but the collection of individual hosts or the computers. So, when two computers want to communicate to each other, either they have to be connected directly or they have some means of connection, some means of device which enable the communication between them. And similarly, the communication might be between host in one different network to the host in the other different network. So on that note also, there should be some means of interconnection that should be established in order to proceed with the communication. So the connecting devices are such intermediate option or such an family of devices which provides the or facilitates the interconnection among the multiple stations or hosts and the interconnection among the different networks. So in this video module, we will be considering the concepts of connecting devices and the types of connecting devices that are present and the layers in which they will be operational and what are all the roles and responsibilities and its operational principles of each individual connecting device in detail. So coming to introduction, so we have known that network is nothing but the collection of hosts. Thus, host as well as a network cannot operate in an isolated manner. So the purpose of network concept was to facilitate communication among the multiple hosts or the computers. So with that definition, host and network has to operate in dependent way, go hand in hand in order to enable the meaningful communication anywhere elsewhere in the network. Thus, we'll consider an example to illustrate how exactly the connecting device operates. So the connecting device usually connects two different scenarios. In the first scenario, it connects and host or a station with another host or a station in order to create a network. Thus, once again, network is nothing but the collection of different stations or the hosts. So in order to connect the multiple hosts, we have a connecting device. So the first prime responsibility of connecting device is to connect the multiple hosts together to create a network. So sometimes host in one network may need to communicate to host in the another network. So on that note, here you are not connecting two hosts directly, but indirectly you are connecting two different networks together. Thus, so the connecting device responsibility is to connect the different hosts together to create a network. Second, to interconnect different networks, which we refer it as internet. So we consider the example here. We have four hosts or the stations which are independent of each other. As we can clearly see, in the first place, these two hosts are connected by making use of a connecting device here. So this is the common point to which these two stations are connected. So this creates one different network. So that is the first case. It connects multiple hosts together to make a network. Similarly, on the other side, I have these two hosts which are connected by making use of a kind of a connecting device. Now, this is a different network and this is a different network. If any one host of this network want to communicate to any other host in this particular network, we need one more connecting device that will make the communication meaningful in terms of internet. So these two networks are interconnected by the concept of internet. So usually the connecting devices is defined, its roles and responsibilities are defined with respect to the particular layer in the OSI module or the TCP/IP module. As we have discussed the basics of basic responsibilities and functions of TCP/IP model, there are five layers we have defined. We have physical layer, we have data link layer, network layer, transport layer, and the application layer. So we'll look into the details of the same. As we have clearly seen, communicating parties has to obey the set of protocols and the set of rules that is defined by the communicating parties in this node. So when they are communicating, if they want to connect, they want to interact with each other, first they need to have an interconnection between them, or they have to have a physical connection, either in terms of wired connection or the wireless connection. The first point-to-point connection or the multi-point connection has to be established. So usually when it comes to the family of connecting devices, we have understood from the basics of TCP/IP model, the physical layer, data link layer, and network layer functionalities, as well as its operations, the layer's operations are implemented in physical devices. That means the physical layer has a particular physical device which will implement its functionality, similarly with respect to data link layer and network layer. When it comes to higher layers, that is application layer as well as the transport layer, most of its functionalities are defined in terms of softwares or in terms of code or in terms of programs. Thus, we call application layer and transport layers are software defined layers, and predominantly the physical layer and data link layer are hardware defined TCP/IP layers, and network has the proper mixture of both hardware as well as the software. So thus, we can clearly see connecting devices and physical entity. We can clearly say that only the physical lower three layers, that is physical layer, data link layer, and network layer, we have a physical structure or a hardware that will implement its functionalities. Because of that, our discussion of connecting devices is restricted, or it is defined, it is confined only to the lower three layers, that is physical layer, data link layer, and network layer. Or I can simply summarize that connecting devices are present only in the lower three layers, that is physical layer, data link layer, and network layer. We'll look into the family of connecting devices with respect to the individual layer in the TCP/IP model. The first category is referred as hub, which is functional at the physical layer. We'll discuss in detail how exactly the hub operates, what are the functionalities of the hub, what are the responsibilities of the hub in detail in the subsequent section. Secondly, we have data link layer. At data link layer, we have link layer switches. From the diagram, it is pretty much clear that hub has the limited functionality at the physical layer only. But when we consider the link layer switches, it has the common area that is shared with respect to the hub. That means the link layer switch has the functionality in the two layers. It is operational at physical layer also, and it is operational at data link layer also. Next, we have network layer. At the network layer, we have a connecting device which is referred as router. Here, the router could be called as three-layer switch, as it is operational at all the three layers, that is physical layer, data link layer, and network layer. So the router manages to incorporate the functions of the link layer switches as well as the hubs also, and the link layer switches manages to implement the functionalities of the data link layer as well as the physical layer also. In this video, we shall discuss individually the operational principles of the link layer switches, hubs, as well as the virtual local area networks. And then we consider its functions and its operational principles. Finally, we'll conclude regarding the roles, the summary of the roles and responsibilities of the connecting device. So first we'll consider the concept of hub. Hub is a physical layer device which is functional only at the lowermost layer of the TCP/IP model, that is a physical layer. If we can remember, the responsibilities of the physical layer is to transport the individual bits from one station to the next station, and it deals predominantly with respect to the electrical and physical properties of the communication mediums we are speaking of, and it deals with the representation of the informations. So thus, at physical layer level, the signals which carry the information within the network, there is a limitation in terms of, since we are speaking of electromagnetic signals or the digital signals, when it is carried in any kind of the physical medium, whether it is wired or wireless medium, so signal which is carrying the information has a limitation in terms of the distance for which it can carry the information, before which the degradation of the information happens because of the attenuation. As if we can remember, the strength of the signal or the concept of attenuation that comes into the any kind of electromagnetic information exchange we are speaking of. So the attenuation concept is nothing but the quality of the signal deteriorates indirectly proportional to the distance, square of the distance. As the distance increases, the strength of the signal goes on decreasing. So to overcome this particular problem in the concept of computer networks, the concept of repeaters comes into picture. So repeater is once again a connecting device which receives the information bits or information signals on one part. So when it is received, the signal should be stronger one, comparatively stronger than or comparatively nearer to its original versions. So because of the particular distance the signal has covered, its quality might have deteriorated. So the repeater receives this particular signal before it becomes too weak or too corrupted. So what exactly repeater does is, it regenerates the signal to its original value or original bit pattern, and it retimes or resynchronizes its timing durations with respect to the original bit pattern that was carried initially. Then this particular repeater sends the refreshed signal, that is regenerated signal, on the other port, so that the limitation on the physical length of the network we had earlier could be overcome. So we shall look into the same by considering this particular diagram. We have two different hosts which are connected by which is connected by making use of a wired communication medium here. So as I have clearly mentioned, we have fixed the length for which the communication happens here. So these two systems are assumed to be very far from each other. So in the process, when the signal is traveling from the source to destination, initially the signal will be the stronger signal, that is in the original strength of the signal is retained when it is initiated. But as the signal travels in the communication medium, so it becomes weak because of the different physical as well as the electrical properties of the communication medium we are speaking of. So what exactly your repeater does is, it receives the signal, it regenerates and retimes the signal that is received corrupted or the weak signal to the original bit pattern that was there at the source part, and the regenerated signal is sent to a particular destination system. Thus, the hub, the repeater act as one of the signal regeneration unit or the connecting device, which will help to overcome the limitation on the physical length of the medium, limitations on the physical length of the medium we had. When we spoke of Ethernet LANs, there was a limitation in terms of the physical length. So if we have two different local area networks which are operating in the bus topology, your repeater could be used to connect two different bus topologies, because there was a limitation on the physical length of the bus topology we have spoken earlier. So which has the physical limitation of around maximum of 500 meters. So if you want to extend the length of the network, the bus topology in this case, you could use a repeater in between so that it can serve as the bridge between two different bus topologies. So this is two different Ethernet LAN segments which are connected by making use of repeaters. So here one key thing we need to remember is these two bus topologies, that is Ethernet LAN segments, are operating in the bus topology. But as the advancements came into picture, most of the Ethernet LANs today make use of a star topology. So in the star topology, in the Ethernet star topology, all the stations are connected together to a single unit which is called as hub. Here, what is the function of hub? Hub is a multi-port device which implements the functionalities which we have referred in the hub. So, referred in the repeater. So, hub is once again a repeater with the multiple ports. So the repeater we considered very recently is nothing but two port network. We had one input port and one output port. If that could be made multi-port device, then that is called as a hub. So usually Ethernet LAN in the star topology makes use of this hub concept. So how exactly the hub operates? So it is the same function of the repeater. So here I have taken a consideration wherein one of the station A want to communicate to station B. So how exactly the implementation happens here? First, the station A sends the frame to the hub. So at the hub, the frame is regenerated to the original bit pattern. And it removes any possible the corrupting noise that was present in the signal. Then it forwards the particular regenerated frame to the all outgoing ports that are present except from the one in which the frame was received. So here, since the A is sending the frame, that frame is received by the hub, which operates on the principle of repeaters, it regenerates the signal, and that regenerated signal is sent on the all the outgoing ports. Since we have four devices here, I have four ports. One is the input port in which the frame is received. So all other ports are considered as the output port. One received copy is now is broadcasted on the all the outgoing ports. Thus, all the stations of the LAN will receive the frame. So that frame is broadcasted here. But A was specifically communicating to B. Now, so dependent on the information that is contained in the frame, all the stations will receive the frame. Since the frame was intended only for B, only B can understand it and it will decapsulate it. And thus it will maintain that particular frame and will deliver to the higher layers. But as the information contained in the frame is not in relation with station C and station D, they'll simply discard that particular frame. So this is how the operation is implemented. So we could summarize the operation principle of hub in terms of hub is a repeater at physical layer device which does not has the filtering capability. So here, as I can clearly see, even though A was directly communicating to B, the frame was sent to all other stations because it is operating in the broadcast mode. Thus, the hub cannot filter the specific frame to a specific, it cannot deliver a specific frame to the specific destination. Thus, it does not have any filtering capability. It does not have the filtering capability because it does not have any link layer address. Thus, it cannot check in the incoming frame to which the destination the frame should be sent. Because of that, the hub and repeater does not have a link layer address. So the major function of the hub is to regenerate the corrupted bit and sends it out from every individual port that is connected apart from the one incoming. So that is about the physical, that is more about the physical layer device, which is repeater or the hub we considered. The second layer device, connecting device, is referred as link layer switch. So which operates at the physical layer as well as the data link layer. So here, the link layer switch's responsibilities could be distinguished in two different domains. Since it is operating in physical layer also and it is operating in the data link layer also, it can have two different responsibilities it is serving. First one is, at the physical layer, it operates as the hub operation. So the link layer switch operate as a hub at the physical layer. Thus, its prime responsibility is to regenerate the signal, all the signal it receives. So, but the additional responsibility or the additional function that is added because it is functional at the data link layer. Since it is functional at data link layer, it is capable of checking the MAC address that is present in the frame that it has received or it is regenerating. Thus, the link layer switch is operational at two layers, that is physical layer and the data link layer. At the physical layer, it operates as a hub, thereby it regenerates the signal, any signal that it receives. At the data link layer, it checks for the MAC addresses. So if you can remember, at the hub, there was no filtering because it cannot check the MAC address. But in the link layer switch, it can check the MAC address, thereby it can specifically select to which destination the frame should be sent. So we'll look into the exact principle once again. The same scenario we'll consider. We have four stations that are connected to the switch. Now, this is not a hub, this is a switch. So all these four stations are connected to the switch. So A want to send some information to the B. As I can clearly see here, the data is preceded by the MAC addresses of the source and the destination station. So A is the source station here and B is the destination station here. So A sends the particular frame to the switch. Upon receiving the particular frame at the physical layer of the switch, it regenerates the signal to its original bit pattern and it retimes it. Once that is done, next to the data link layer, it checks for the MAC addresses of the destination. So here, the switch has received the data from A. It clearly means it has to have the record regarding which are the connecting devices that are connected to it and where it is connected, that is port to which it is connected. So it has four ports. Station A is connected to port 1, station B is connected to port 2, station C is connected to 3, and station D is connected to 4. Thus, the switch has received the data from station A on port 1 and it has to be specifically sent to station B, which is on the port 2. Thus, it looks into the concept of switching table, wherein there is a mapping between the MAC addresses to the port numbers. So here the station A's MAC address is this, that is 46 bits in length, that is 6 bytes in length. So this MAC address is mapped to port number 1. This station, I'll look into the final part of it. So the MAC address ending with 41 corresponds to station A, which is mapped to the port 1 of the switch. The MAC address ending with 42 is station B, is mapped to port 2, and so on. Thus, once switch receives that particular frame, it will look into the destination address, that is B here, and then it will map from the switching table. So B is present on which particular port? So since the B is present on port number 2, the frame has to be forwarded only to this particular link. The same will be implemented. So thus, the prime difference between and hub as well as a switch is in terms of filtering. So the link layer switch, since it is capable of checking the MAC addresses, it can check the MAC address of the destination. Thus, it will make a decision with respect to which particular output port, on which particular output port the frame has to be forwarded or it has to be sent. So it has a layer to implement this. The link layer switch has a facility of the switching table, so which is used for the filtering decision. So we can clearly say that from the operational principle of link layer switches, it will just look into the MAC address of the MAC address that is present in a frame, but it cannot change the MAC address that is present in a frame. So the next concept we will be discussing is the concept of transparent switches. As the name itself indicates, transparent switch is a situation wherein the stations which are connected to that particular transparent switch are completely unaware of the fact that there is a switch to which they have connected. That is why the name the transparent switch has been given. So the advantages of having the implementation of transparent switch is that if a particular switch is added or deleted from the system, it is not required for you to reconfigure the system, as their presence is not felt by the host which are connecting to it. So according to the standard defined IEEE 802.1D specifications, in order to implement the transparent switches, it has to have three criteria that has to be fulfilled. The first criteria is that the frame has to be forwarded from one station to the another station. So here, this is the responsibility of the primary link layer switch. So to this, two additional requirements or the criteria that has been added. The first one is, while explaining the concept of link layer switches, I mentioned there is a forwarding table or there is a switching table that is present, which will let the switch to know on which output port the frame has to be sent with respect to the MAC address that is present in the frame. So here, if the system admin has to manually update this particular forwarding table and switching table every time, this is a tedious process. So thus, the transparent switch has to come up with a criteria of a learning from the frame movements in order to automatically update that particular forwarding table or the switching table. So thus, the forwarding table has to be automatically updated or created by making use of by the concept of learning from the frame movements in the network. And one has to, the last criteria says that one has to make sure there are no loops that are present in the system, so that to avoid any ambiguities in the routing process. So as I've clearly stated, the three criteria has to be fulfilled, that is forwarding, learning, and the last one is the loop prevention. So coming to the first concept of forwarding, forwarding is nothing but the transparent switch has to correctly forward the frames as we have discussed with respect to the link layer switches. So the next we'll consider the concept of learning. So when earlier cases the switch was defined or switch was invented, this forwarding table or the switching tables were static. The term static here means that every time the network was created or the switch was connected, the system admin has to manually prepare the switching table, which comprises of two columns. First column is nothing but the link layer address or the MAC address of the device that is connected. And the second column is the port number to which it is connected. So while making the forwarding process, to filter the port on which the communication has to be completed is made on this particular switching table. So the initial days switches, this switching table or the forwarding table was static. That means the system admin has to manually update, create an entry for each device that is connected. So the drawback with this particular approach was, if any device is added to the network or any device is removed from the network, on that note, the system admin has to manually update these informations, which is a tedious process, and the table has to be manually updated or modified. And at the same time, there are situations such as if the physical address itself is changed. So the physical address usually changes when I replace the network interface card that is present in a system. On that note also, once again, the system admin has to manually update this particular entry in the switching table. So which is not very acceptable in many cases as the stations are moving across. On that particular note, one station may come in the network, one may go out of the network. We cannot expect the system admin to monitor this entire operations and manually update the static switching table that was present. So to overcome it, if the switching table or the forwarding table could be made dynamic. So here dynamic is nothing but once it is initialized, dependent on the communication that is happening, this forwarding table or the switching table will learn the frame movement, and by itself it will create the switching table or the forwarding table that is intended. Thus, the mapping between the MAC addresses to the ports is done implemented automatically. Such tables are called as the dynamic tables. So to implement this, switch has to look into the destination address that is present in the frame as well as the source address that is present in the frame. So the destination address is used to forward the making the forward decision. At the same time, the source address is The source address is used to adding entries to the table, and it is used for the learning process in order to update the forwarding table or the switching table. Let us look into this particular scenario to elaborate much on the process. So we have four stations A, B, C and D which are connected to the switch on different ports. So that is A is connected to port 1, B is connected to 2, C is connected to 3 and D is connected to 4. So how exactly this particular table is built? So as I've clearly stated, the switching table or the forwarding table has two columns. One is the address part, which will have the physical address or the MAC address of the device that is connected. And the second column has port, so on which port the particular host is connected. So if I'll consider the first case wherein A want to communicate to station D. So on that note, A will send the frame to the switch. So when the frame is connected, so the frame is received, since the switch does not has any entries initially, this is the initial part when I don't have any, I have not started the learning phase yet. So A sends the frame, and this particular frame will go out in all the three ports here. Why it will go all in all three ports? Because the address table, the switching table, the forwarding table does not has any entries. Because of this, the frame that is received on port 1 will be sent on all the other ports, that is port 2, 3 as well as 4. But as I have clearly stated, the frame will have two entries. One is source address, another one is destination address. The destination address is used for the forwarding decision, and the source address is used to update the entry in the forwarding table. Since this is the first frame I have received, I'll update the physical address of the source and to port to which it is connected. Thus, I have learned one device and its physical address as well as the port number. Secondly, once the frame has been received from the station D, the second situation in which the station D want to communicate to station B. Once again, when the frame receives this, I don't have an entry for station B, since the B has not yet initiated the communication process. Thus, once again, it will send the frame to two other ports. It will not forward the packet on link 1, as the physical address is not matching the B with A. Since already I have the entry for A, now I'll update the switching table with the destination address or the source address of station D and its port number. So third scenario is in similarly this way, the communication is continued until the switching table learns and it updates the entire table about every individual port that is communicated. Once the entire table is built, if any one of the station want to communicate now it will not operate in the broadcast mode. As I clearly stated, once I had entry for A, none of the frame was broadcasted into the port number 1. Since A, now I know what is the MAC address of A. So similarly, once this is implemented, now if A want to communicate to B, already there is an entry for B here. Thus, once the switch receives the frame, it will look into the destination address and the mapping is done to the particular port and the frame is forwarded to this particular port only. So one problem with this particular approach is that if one of the station will not initiate, if it will not initiate the frame transmission part, its entry will be completely absent in the forwarding table or the switching table. So next we'll consider the concept of loop problem. So usually the transparent switches operates very fine in the concept of, by the concept of learning as well as forwarding. But the problem comes when I have the presence of redundant switches. The concept of redundant switches here means that many times the network admin will opt for two switches, in which one is in the active mode and other one is in the backup mode. If something happens and the active switch goes out of order, on that note, the entire network will go out of order. To prevent that, a redundant switch, a same switch is implemented at the back end, which is called as a backup switch. So on that note, for each individual pair, there will be a one a pair of switch will be there for each pair of LANs to make it more reliable. So thus, if a switch fails, another switch will take its position and it will work until the original switch is repaired or it is replaced. Though the redundancy provides here offers the reliability, it provides the difficulty or the drawback in terms of loops. So the loop is created only when there are two or more broadcasting LANs that are present. So the same example is illustrated here. I have two different local area networks, that is local area network 1 and local area network 2. These local area networks are connected by making use of a switches here, and they are interconnected by making use of two switches. So these are the redundant switch. Both performs the same operations, but to have the redundancy, to have the reliability, the system admin has chosen another system, another switch as a backup switch. How exactly the loops are created in the systems? So I have connected two LANs here, which are connected by making use of two link layer switches. So now the station, these are the ports, and since I have two switches, I have two forwarding tables. So now A has some information that has to be sent to D. Since this is the initial part of the communication, I am not manually updating the switching table. I am going for the learning mechanism. So I have to learn from the frame movement on which port which device is connected and what is the port number on which the frame has to be sent. So at the initial part, since A want to communicate to D, it will forward the data. So the data is forwarded such that, so both of the switches from the learning process, they came to know that source is A, which is connected to the port 1. So the same redundant information is updated on the both the switches. Once it is done, the frame is sent to the local area network 2. It is broadcasted on the port 2. Thus, this entire LAN 2 will get a copy of the same frame, that is the sent by the station A. Now there is one copy that is received from one switch. This is that copy, and similarly there is one more copy that is received. Why exactly am I receiving this? The second copy is because of the second switch that is present. So this switch receives a copy from here, and that will broadcast it here. And similarly, this switch also receives this particular copy, the same redundant copy. Because of that, in this local area network, there are two copies of the same information that is present. Since both of the switches didn't have any information regarding the destination switch, destination device, that is D, it will simply forward the frame. Now, since it is sent by the left switch as well as the right switch, it is simply broadcasted. Because of that, the copy sent by the right switch will be received by the left switch, and the copy sent from the left switch will be received from the right switch. Because of this, once again, the local area network which had two copies, one of the copy will be once again forwarded to the these two switches since they does not know where exactly is D. So the copy here received is from this switch. The copy I have received here is from this switch. That is, right switch receives the copy from the left. Left switch receives the copy from the right switch. And the same copy is broadcasted here back to the local area network 1. Once again, it will have two copies. And this operation will continue further. I have once again two switches, two copies of the switches, and this operation is repeated again and again. So this will create a loop. The process will continue. Since every time the frame is received, the switch operates as a repeater also. So it regenerates the signal. So each individual iterations, there are fresh copies or the new generated frames that are present. Because of this, this will create overall, this will bring down the overall operation of the particular network. So, in order to illustrate the functional operation of a spanning tree algorithm, we'll consider an system of interconnected local area networks. I have clearly mentioned here, I have four local area networks and five switches which are implementing or the facilitating the interconnection by making use of the switches. So each of the switches here will be having a specific port numbers or the interface numbers on which the local area network is clearly mentioned. For example, if I consider the switch S3, so on port 1, local area network 2 is connected. On port 2, local area 3 is connected. And on port 3, local area network 4 is connected. So once this is known, the next task is to represent the same by making use of the graphical representation of the same, in which the interconnections are weighted by making use of the cost matrix value or the cost metric for each individual arc or each individual interconnections. So as we have considered in the subsequent section, the communication from switch to local area network is weighted with the minimum hop count value of 1, and the communication from local area network to the switch is weighted as 0 as the minimum hop from local area network to the switch. And the same way, all the other values are updated in the entire graph. So we have made use of the same notations everywhere, that is, so we'll try to understand how exactly the process of spanning algorithm goes. So the entire process of spanning tree algorithm involves three major steps. The first step, wherein to apply the spanning tree algorithm, the process starts from one single node in the network or one switch in the network, and in every individual iteration, the algorithm is applied to the next subsequent connected switches or the connected the local area networks, and it goes step by step to reach out every individual local area network and every individual switch in the entire network. So in order to do that, we have to first identify the point at which the algorithm functioning starts or the process starts. So to do that, each individual switch in the network will be having a built-in ID, which is usually represented in terms of serial numbers. So every individual switch will broadcast its ID to all other switches in the network so that it knows every individual switches that are present in the network. So once every switch in the network knows the ID of all the other switches in the network, the decision is made to select one of the switch with the smallest ID as the root switch, and sometimes it is also called as the root of the tree. I repeat, the switch with the smallest ID is selected as the root switch or the root of the tree. For our example, we have assumed switch 1 as the root switch. So next, the dependent on the arc cost values we have given, that is metric value in terms of minimum hop count we have given, the algorithm tries to visit all the nodes one at a time. For example, the switch 1 is connected to LAN 1 and LAN 2 at the first step. So as we have clearly stated, from switch to local area network, the cost value is 1. Thus, from this root switch, in order to reach LAN 1, the minimum shortest path is 1. And similarly, to reach local area network 2, the minimum cost value is 1. Once this is done, the next algorithm will be implemented at these two stages. That is, it is implemented at LAN 1 and it is implemented at LAN 2. So, as we have seen, from switch 1 to LAN 1, the cost value was 1. But from LAN 1 to the switch 2, the cost value was 0. Thus, 1 plus 0 will account for 1. At the other side, LAN 2 is connected to S4. Thus, and at the same time, it is connected to S3. So, once again, since the communication is from LAN to the switch, the subsequent cost matrix value, the minimum hop count value here is 0 and here is also 0. Thus, 0 plus 1 was 1, 1 plus 0 is once again 1. So, in order to reach S3 from LAN 2, the cost value is equal to 1. Next, in order to reach S4 via LAN 2, the cost value is equal to 1. Thus, we have now, at the first step, we started at S1. In the second step, we visited LAN 1 and LAN 2. In the third step, we have covered S2, S3 and S4. Now, next algorithm will be implemented at, the same shortest path algorithm will be implemented at S2, S3 and S4. So, when we implement it, I can clearly say that here, from S2, there was only one path in the forward direction, that is from S2 to LAN 3. Since the communication is from switch to the LAN, the cost value will be equal to 1. So, earlier cost value, summative cost value was 1, 1 plus 1 will become 2. So, the total cost to reach LAN 3 from switch 1 is equal to 2 now. Similarly, from S4, there was one path to LAN 4 and the cost value is equal to 2. So, now this completes the spanning tree algorithm. We have one more switch. We have LAN 4 from which the next algorithm will be implemented at LAN 4. Now you may ask question in terms of why we have not considered the connection from S3 to LAN 4 and from S3 to LAN 3. So the count here was 1. If I take into consideration this, the total count will become this path was not taken into consideration while we assigned the cost value, because if this path is taken, once again this will form a loop here. Because of that, this link is omitted. Similarly, if I take this path into consideration, this will create a loop here. Because of that, this link is also omitted. So thus, either I have to reach S5 from LAN 3 or from LAN 4. If I take LAN 3 to S5, the cost value will become 3. From LAN 4 to S5, if I take into consideration, earlier cost was 2 and the new cost is equal to 2 plus 0, that is equal to 2. So, this is the shortest path as well as a spanning tree in the system of switches. So, we have made use of Dijkstra algorithm here, which is intended to find out the a network or the topology without any loops. Now, in the original network, if we compare this, the combination of the shortest path will create the shortest tree. So now I have created, I have identified the shortest paths here. From the shortest path, I have clearly stated which is an identical path to reach any switch or any individual LAN with only the single path that is available. So, if you take into consideration any of the cases here, I have only one path from the root. So, if I want to reach LAN 3, I have only one option, that is from S1 to LAN 1, LAN 1 to S2 and S2 to LAN 3. If you take S3, I have only single path via LAN 2. If you take LAN 4, I have single path via LAN 2 and S4. Similarly, with respect to S5 also, there are no multiple paths available for any destination, any switch or any local area network in this particular case. So, this case was found out by applying the spanning tree algorithm using Dijkstra algorithm. So, based on the spanning tree we have obtained, we mark the final network, we mark some of the ports as the forwarding ports and some of the port as the blocking ports. So if I take into consideration the original network, I had this dotted line, the links indicated by the dotted lines that were present. But after applying the spanning tree algorithm, these particular links were omitted or removed from the or not identified as a shortest path. Because of that, these particular paths are referred as the blocking ports. So to any of the links to which this particular any of the ports to which these links are connected are called as a blocking ports. So if you refer the original diagram, so this is port 1, port 2 and port 3. So for a switch S3, port 2 and port 3 are referred as a blocking ports. That means none of the frames could be forwarded through that particular port, so that so that the loops are not formed. So if I forward any frame to the port 2, then there will be a loop in this situation. So if I forward any particular frame to port 2 of S3, then there will be loop here. So thus removing these two ports will make my entire topology, removing these three ports, that is port 2 and 3 of S3, next port 1 of SY, will make my topology a spanning tree topology without any loops that are present. And similarly, the solid line will indicate the forwarding ports. So wherever I have solid lines, that solid lines could be made use to forward the frames to the next intermediate node that is present. So this is the logical connection of the LAN systems for forwarding ports with the blocking ports. So as we can clearly see, there is only one path from any one LAN to any other LAN. From LAN 1 to LAN 3, there is single path. From LAN 2 to LAN 4, there is a single path. But in the original topology, from LAN 2 to LAN 4, there were two paths that are available. Via S4, one path was there. From via S3, another path was there. Now, since we have blocked this particular port, there is only one single path that is available. So thus, we have reached the or we have justified the basic requirement of spanning tree algorithm. Every individual LAN or every individual switch has single path that is available. Thus, there are no loops that are created. So thus, we have clearly mentioned the concept of spanning tree algorithm in this particular case. It will not, sometimes it may require the manual entries. Every time it is not true. If we have the software package that will carry out this particular process, then the table updation could be made dynamic. So link layer switch has multiple advantages over the other connecting device family we consider, that is hub. So the first advantage is in terms of the collision elimination. So we have clearly considered the concept of the link layer devices earlier. So it eliminates collision in terms of by making use of an independent operating domain. So whenever a frame want to communicate, it is not required to access the shared medium. Since every individual station is connected to the switch over a dedicated link, it can straight away start communicating to the switch, thus thereby eliminating the collision compared to the earlier case of the hub. So the elimination of the collision guarantees the increased average bandwidth that is available for all the hosts that are present in the network. So if you are making use of the switched LAN, the carrier sensing as well as the collision detection is not required. Since we are making use of the star topology, it is not required for a user to sense the medium and at the same time not required to detect the collision. That means the each host is free to transmit at any given instant of time. Second application is in terms of the connection of the heterogeneous devices. Since the link layer switch can device is a connecting device which can allow the connection of multiple types of devices with different protocols at the physical layer, it can support the multiple data rates. At the same time, it can support the different transmission medias also. So one key thing that has to be satisfied is in terms of all the different types of medias, different protocols of the physical layer that is implemented has to make use of the same data link layer frame format. For example, if you consider on one side, I might be having a device which is connected by making use of the twisted pair cable. Thus, it can transmit the data at 100 Mbps. So if it is connected to a link layer switch, on the other side, I might have a fiber optic cable device which is connected via fiber optic cable and it can receive the data at the rate of 100 Mbps rate. Thus, the switch will allow an user to connect a different devices with different capabilities and it can support the different data rates at the same time. The only thing that has to be kept in mind is in terms of the data format has to remain same irrespective of any kind of the device we are making use of. So we have considered the concept of hubs and the link layer switches till now. And in the subsequent sections, we will consider the concept of routers. In the next video, we will consider the concept of routers as well as the virtual LANs. So under hubs and link layer switches, we discussed the introduction to the connecting devices. We discussed the concept of repeaters as well as the link layer switch, which is called as a hub. We considered the concept of the extended version of a repeater, which is called as hub, which operates at the physical layer. Then we consider the concept of link layer switch. How if the filtering of the MAC address is incorporated into the hub, how it will make it as a two-layer device, that is link layer switches. Then how exactly the transparent switch implementation could be done in order to enhance its enhance its operation at the same time, create a network without any particular loops by making use of the spanning tree algorithms. So in the coming video lecture, we'll consider the concept from the connecting devices, that is routers, which operates at the network layer, and similarly the advanced topic, which is referred as the virtual local area networks. Thank you.